visions in my head. People tell me that I'm crazy. I tell them that's exactly it. I've got reasons for
I am so glad you guys are here. Can you guys give a little backstory? I know that you're from Texas originally. In Washington. Also, yeah. I live for your Instagram stories in your home.
Oh my gosh.
Because so they're sweet. The most beautiful things I've ever seen.
I love Washington. It's in the summer.
It's beautiful.
Yeah.
It's gorgeous.
It really is. Okay, so how we started? Is
yeah,
that?
No, a little background, like where did you grow up? Where did you go to school?
Oh, on each of us.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm Mary Ralph. I'm from Austin, Texas, Texas girl. I moved to LA when I started college, Malibu actually. I went to Pepperdine, which was so fun. I wish I still lived in Malibu.
It's
I don't
so beautiful.
Know why I ever left. And yeah, that's kind of how I landed in LA. I worked for Startup Culture in college, for Bumble, doing influencer marketing, social, all of that sort of stuff. When I graduated, I started a business with my twin sister who still lives in Texas. So I was going back and forth a ton, but kind of wanted to plant my roots more in LA. And I love home. So mom, if you're listening, I might move one day. But for now, LA's the place for me. So that's sort of how I landed here. I live in Brentwood now and obviously work for Daily Drills, and we'll probably cover how that story came about later. Yeah. But that's how I am where I am right now.
I love it.
Yeah.
Well, I'm from Washington, like you said earlier. I moved to LA 7 years ago, I think now. I stopped counting. But I moved here originally for school. I went to LMU, Loyola Marymount. I grew up traveling to LA literally like 3 times a year. My mom loves LA. I feel like she planted that seed in me from a young age. She's like, okay, you know, when it's time for college. So when that time came, I moved. I wanted to be in a big city and try something totally different. Washington's amazing, but it rains, I mean, basically the whole year. And so I really wanted to be somewhere sunny and different. And I fell in love after school. I mean, I graduated early, but I just needed to stay in the city. I love the culture, the art, the people. I'm super inspired by, you know, the city at large. And so I just knew that I wanted to stay planted here. So how many years out of school am I now? 3 years. And I'm still here, and I hope to have my babies here someday. I love it.
Every time I think about Pepperdine, I just think of PCA.
Oh my gosh, it's real life PCA. That's why I wanted to go.
Yeah, no, that was everyone's dream school. I feel like when you were younger and you're 12 watching Zoe 101, it's like, that's what I'm going
to
do.
Oh, I think I told my dad that, and he was like, good luck. I would love to go if I were you too. And literally fast forward, and I went, and I was Zoe IRL.
No, literally, you really pulled it off. Okay,
really pulled it off.
Let's get into like Daily Drills. How did that come about?
Do you want to talk?
Yeah. So Ralph and I have been friends for how many years?
Probably, since freshman year. Yeah.
Wait, college. How did you guys meet?
Instagram.
That's probably a good one. Literally Instagram. We started a fashion account together, and we didn't know each other. We had never met. It was 5 girls. We thought we were cutting edge by doing like the first Instagram influencer, quote unquote, account that was run by multiple people. So that's how we met. And then after college, kind of like finding your footing in LA, we started a Bible study and became best friends. And so it kind of happened after that, but we had been friends for a while before we came super close.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And Ralph always had her hand in the influencer world. She's an influencer herself and does social media. She ran a couple different social media accounts. I came from a startup background doing marketing, and so we had always kind of collaborated on ideas and talked about different ventures that we might want to do one day. I had my own sweater line briefly. She had her own t-shirt
in like merch. 7th grade.
Yeah. And so we kind of always had just like naturally gravitated towards fashion, and we were just iterating on different ideas. And literally on a Wednesday night, I texted off and I was like, okay, we just have to start activewear. We were both actually doing some freelance work for a woman who's, you know, really well versed in the production merchandising industry. And so we came to her with our idea, and we're like, okay, we just want to start activewear. Like, it might just be one capsule, one collection. You know, we just kind of want to test the market. This is actually like at the very beginning of the pandemic.
Yeah.
And so we were like, people are gravitating towards lounge. Like, let's just go for it. And at that meeting, she was like, no, I want to be a partner. And we were like, what? With us? Really? And she's like, yeah, no, I want equity in this company. And that was kind of like that marking for us. It was like, okay, we're on to something. Like, let's just go full-fledged, all in. And so I took my 10,000 and Ralph took her 10,000. And it felt like a lot at the time. We're like, let's just bet on ourselves. Let's just put it in, try, learn, test. And if it doesn't succeed, like, we have learnings. And so really that's how we started. My sister came up with the name Daily Drills. We had a name and the trademark was taken on it, and we're like, crap, okay, but like Daily Drills is cool. And it just kind of like stuck, and it lingered, and we felt like there was something just strong about it.
Yeah.
And so in November 2020, we put our black leggings and our black biker shorts. And I mean, most of our money went to legal fees. So it was really, really what we could conjure up at the time.
Yeah, like three black leggings is pretty much what we could afford.
Then. Some white t-shirts. We were like, let's just put our patch on it and see how it does. And I mean, the feedback was incredible.
Yeah, it worked. Yeah, it's crazy.
When did you guys decide to like leave what you guys were doing before and go like full time into daily drills?
I feel like for me personally, I was doing social media in the social media space. I was helping other businesses grow their online platforms. And I felt like, okay, it's really fun to help other people and other women create what they're passionate about. But what am I passionate about? I've done influencer stuff on my own account, but I kind of wanted to grow my own personal brand versus working for a lot of other brands. So I kind of think that's where I was at. It was in the middle of quarantine in July is actually when Kennedy texted me that night. So it was kind of that season of slowness that everyone felt last summer probably. So I feel like that's kind of when I decided I had extra time and I had extra resources and I was sort of looking for the next thing. So it was perfect timing for me.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I was full-time. I had been full-time with a food company for about three and a half years and just kind of felt that itch in my soul to start my own venture. And so I was kind of riding that wave of tension for a little bit. And we really decided on this. I think September is when we like finally capitalized on the idea. And then by January, I had quit my job and gone full-time with Daily Drills.
I love that.
After I was begging Kennedy, okay, you need to be with me all the time.
Like, please. Where do you even begin? Like, you guys said you had this idea, you wanted to do it, you went and met with someone. After that, like, what were your first steps?
It's a great question. I feel like our first big step was finding a name. I know Kennedy touched on that, but like finding a name.
It's the hardest thing. It was the hardest thing.
Yeah. And then it made it actually feel like it was going to be something once we named it and put it on paper and got a lawyer to draft up an LLC and a contract and got all of that like not as fun and glamorous stuff out of the way. I feel like that was a huge step. Saying yes was a huge step when Kennedy finally quit her job, when I went in full time. I think another big step was we have a partner, as Kennedy was mentioning, so getting that whole situation sorted and then finding our very first piece. We felt a lot of fabric. Tried on a lot of different things. We went to probably like 50 stores one day and tried on everything at every store and we're like,
here's the thing.
I don't like this.
We have expensive taste.
Yeah.
But we couldn't afford our expensive taste.
So we had to get a little creative and our other partner helps us with manufacturing and production, so it was so nice to have someone that was well-versed in that space to be able to teach us and guide us along the way. I feel like if you're listening and that's something that you want to do, just getting a mentor that has done it before, even if it's not going to be your partner, but just someone that you can ask questions to and ask advice. It might be your mom or your dad that started a business. It might be someone in the actual space that you're doing. But I felt like that guide helped us because we didn't know what the next steps were supposed to be, you know?
We came to her with what we liked and what we were wearing and what people were asking about on social media and said, okay, here's what we're thinking. And then she'd be like, okay, this fabric is great, but it's not that durable. This fabric is awesome, but it only comes in a few colorways. So she really gave us that foundation, and I feel like probably 4 years of knowledge. I mean, she has 20 plus years of knowledge in the field, but you know, that 4 years of knowledge that we would have had to like really grind and learn the hard way, she kind of brought to the table. And so we just gave her pieces we loved and then started iterating. Okay, we would want the leggings to be a little shorter. We would want the waistband to be a little bit tighter. We want more of a compression fabric. So we started fitting those. And then really, I mean, we started as an activewear company, but we soon learned that people were really loving the loungewear space. And Ralph, for the longest time, was telling me, Kennedy, we have to do an oversized crew neck. I was like, Ralph, no, we are an activewear brand. We need to like maintain the vision, the identity. Nobody knows us yet. She's like, Kennedy, let's just test it. And it was crazy. We've restocked that crew neck probably 4 times and it sells out within 24 to 48 hours. It's nuts. And so really like, we're now kind of landing in that transitional piece category where you can wear it to your workout. You can wear it to brunch. You can wear it to a meeting.
You can wear it to a podcast.
I mean, yeah, literally.
Yeah.
You can really dress it up or down. And so while we started as an activewear company, it's really morphed into much more than that.
Yeah, and I think that Kennedy and I were just talking about it on the way over here. I think we're going to laugh in a year at this podcast at where we are, because I think we're going to maintain our vision of Daily Drills and what we set out for it to be, which is transitional pieces, things that girls feel comfortable, confident, styled in. But I just think that we're going to have so many other pieces that we couldn't have dreamed of, and we're going to be like, wow, we started so small, and we have listened to our customers and evolved from there. Like, people DM us crazy ideas all the time, and thankfully we have the resources to be able to create anything from nothing, you know? So I think that it'll just be fun to see in a year or two where we evolve to, but right now it's mostly active and lounge.
I think that's really important, though, regardless of what industry you're in and what you're doing, the idea of, like, holding things with an open hand and, like, allowing yourself to evolve and change. Because even in, like, my own career, like, certain things that I'm doing, like, that was never the beginning vision, but it's so much better now. But I always, I think for me, it was a little bit hard to kind of let go of the vision that I had before and, like, step into other things because I was so set on what I thought I wanted. And I didn't know what I wanted, you know? Yeah, also, so I was 17, 18 when I started. So, like, why would I, you know?
And it's good to start with a vision, I think. I think that that helps you start. And I think the biggest hurdle sometimes is starting. But, yes, like you said, hold it with an open hand because you never know. Some things might come your way that you have to say yes to and step into versus just, no, this is what I set out to do and I'm doing this and that only.
Yeah, you know? Those blinders, I feel like, really stop you from exploring so many different categories and styles and variants. And I mean, we started with women and now we're developing pieces for men because so many girls were like, there's nothing that I can buy for my boyfriend. My boyfriend's been stealing my oversized crew neck. And we're like, oh, okay. So, like, women are the primary shoppers, but there's also this, like, need that isn't being met for men. And so how can we step into that? We're just seeing so many
smart
things.
Yeah. That is so smart. How did you guys originally get your sales? Was it from, like, people that followed you on social media, friends? Like, what was the main source?
Ralph has an extremely – she's not going to say it herself, so I'll say it. She has an extremely loyal following. I mean, people live, breathe, die, whatever Ralph posts.
So sweet.
And I always knew that, and that's why I was like, she would make a great asset and partner to me because we bring totally different skill sets to the table. But something that's so special about her is really her cult-like following. And I didn't understand the depth of that until we started a business because those followers have really transitioned to our brand. And it's crazy. Like, Kenzie, we will post a question on stories. What color do you want next? And I'm not kidding. You will have to scroll for 5 minutes to read all of their responses. It's they're leaned in. They want to hear what's coming next. They feel like they're supporting Ralph and I and what we're creating. And a lot of young girls who, especially now, like, it's easier to start a business than ever. Everything's at your fingertips with TikTok, with Instagram, how-to videos, stuff like that. But people want to look up to people who are similar age to them, maybe went to school for something of the same caliber and want to know that next step. And so I feel like we've just had such a leaned in audience. I mean, our first round of sales, like, we laugh at it now. We thought it was so good. I don't even know. We probably did like $20,000 in sales. And we're like, oh my gosh. And then really that pot just grew bigger and we were able to invest in pieces that we were most excited about. And that's when we really like adopted that continued cult like following.
And I think that our followers like to tune in to us because if they tell us that they want this sort of color, they see that color being made. So then that's why they keep investing because they think if I write this in, which it is true, if they write it in, we'll make it, we'll do it. And I think one of the smartest things we did, that's Kennedy's idea. She bragged on me, so I get to brag on her. She just has the strategy business marketing mindset. I love marketing. I love all of that, but I'm more creative in big picture, but Kennedy actually knows how to execute things. So she was like, okay, I feel like we should turn our Instagram on private before we launch. And then everyone had to request to get into our Instagram account. And all the people that requested got a password that allowed them to enter the site 12 hours before.
Yeah.
We literally decided this the day of. We're like, okay, we should do this tonight. It was the day before we launched. And then I think at like 9 p.m. we opened the site, or we shared the password on our Instagram account that was private. So only those, like, I think it was 2,000 people could go in and pretty much by the morning when we opened up to everyone, everything was sold out. So I feel like that just kind of, like, you're part of our friend circle, our friend group, the first in the know.
I feel like that really helped us at the beginning get that first wind of sales that can be super, super hard to kind of get when you're starting out a brand.
I think people just love being involved too and yeah. feeling like you guys are their friend and then feeling heard. Also, from like obviously on an influencer marketing standpoint, that's like where I am. I totally understand that. But I think like the thing that people miss out on is that's literally like free market research. Like you don't have yeah. to do anything. These mm-hmm. people are telling you, these are your shoppers already and are telling you exactly what you want. So it's really cool. Okay, I saw you guys are recently in print. How does that happen? Yes. Like what's the process to that?
You know, we actually don't know ourselves. Us Weekly, is it US or Us Weekly?
Yeah.
I'm not sure, whichever one.
We love them.
We love them, but they featured us in a story.
And you didn't even know?
Yeah, I almost missed it. I was like looking through our unread DMs.
In an Instagram story.
Yeah, in an Instagram story. And so I reached out to her. I was like, oh my gosh, thank you so much for the feature. Like, we'd love to lean in further with you. So we sent the social media coordinator some pieces. And she was like, oh, let me get you into the buzz section. And so it's been so crazy. I mean, it's such a God thing, the amount of people who have totally championed us and surrounded us, the amount of DMs. I mean, we'll get assistants who are like assistants for big influencers or talent, and they'll be like, oh, my boss would love this piece, will you send it to me? And I mean, it's just, it's wild. Yeah. I don't know where the momentum really started. I can't even really put my finger on it, but it just has continued to evolve. Like Ralph shared a picture yesterday of our piece that we're launching this week, and we had more shares than units.
Wow.
So we're like, oh, you know.
That is so cool. As far as like building a team and leading, and obviously you guys have a partner, what are things that you really look for and value in like maybe a potential hire?
I feel like Kennedy, you have to take this question. She's like the best leader of all time.
I don't know about that.
Before we just hired two new interns, and this is just a funny story, and then you can answer the question. But Kennedy had like a full Google Doc. I don't know if it's called a Google Doc.
Google what Form. Is it? Google
you
form.
Are so administrative.
She's
yeah.
she's a Google it. Form Very. Maker. I don't even know.
Are
how
you
to
a
make
one?
A Google Form.
I'm a one.
Yeah,
me
I
too.
So see that. Yes.
I have a three.
Yep. I have a three too. Yep.
I graduated towards threes.
We hire yeah. threes.
Yeah.
Okay. It's perfect.
Yeah. But Kennedy made this full Google form of like that what their Alfred order was, what their Enneagram was, what inspires them, what motivates them, all of the things. And I was like, oh my gosh, that's brilliant, because you kind of want to know all those things before you hire someone, or at this point we'd already hired them, but just like
yeah. Yeah.
to inspire them and motivate them, you want to know all of that. But
yeah,
I feel like
I mean, listen, I don't know what I know about hiring. I know being on the other end of things, what kind of culture I want to work in, what kind of leaders I want to surround myself with, and what inspires me at the end of the day. And I know that any environment where I've been inspired, it's been a scenario where I've worked my ass off for the brand. And so really when we were thinking about hiring, I wanted to hire for character over gifts, because you can teach talent, but you can't teach character at the mm-hmm. end of the day. So I wanted people who were honest, trustworthy, who had a strong conviction to work hard and hustle. And we also are super transparent with both of our interns, and we're going to have to start building out a team pretty soon here. But we're really transparent with them. Like whatever they want to learn at the end of the day, we want it to be a valuable experience for them. And it's a two-way street, right? Like we want to, and Ralph's so good at setting culture. Ralph shows up to work with a smile on her face every single day. I mean, you cannot rain on her parade, and that's something I've really learned from her. But it just makes you want to lean in. It makes you want to work the extra hours. It's exciting. It's exhilarating. It's a culture where having fun isn't hard. And I think if you set that, it's like all the hard work kind of like falls to the sides. We'll be packing, I don't know, 400 orders in a day, but we'll turn on music and we'll go to margaritas after, and we make it a fun experience. And so it's long-winded, but basically when I'm hiring, I try to look for character. I try to look for people who I want to work with every single day, who want to learn, who are obviously competent and capable, but there are so many competent, capable people out there. So at the end of the day, somebody who wants to learn, who wants to grow, who has a great attitude and shows up and is ready to have a good time.
Yeah, and I think that something when you've hired someone, a really good tip is to give them or to make them feel like they have ownership of the brand. Our interns have our passwords to literally everything, and I think we obviously have a lot of work because it's just Kennedy and I mm-hmm. and them two, but I think that once you give them tons of tasks, they can actually see their personal work contributing to the brand and the brand's success. So I feel like the more ownership someone, an employee, an intern, anyone has, they feel like they're valued and valuable. I feel like that's when they do the best work.
Mm-hmm.
I completely agree with everything you said, especially the ownership thing. That's something I learned in like my internship in college, and that was a huge thing.
Seriously.
The more someone feels any sort of ownership, the more they're going to lean in.
Yeah.
What is a day in the life like as running daily drills? I know it's probably different every day, but still.
It's not glamorous. It's not sexy.
It normally starts with biker shorts and a sweatshirt. That's pretty much what we wear every day because we do get down and dirty. I would say Kennedy and I normally start the morning with a workout. We are either testing our new pieces. We have a new active situation coming out soon. So we normally go to a workout class in the morning. Come to the office around 10, would you say? 9:30, 10.
Yeah.
Pack some orders. Do customer support. Get our office ready. Talk to our interns. Look through what's going to happen for the day.
There are so many different things that happen. I mean, we have to plan our pipeline about 6 months in advance just because of the amount of time. I mean, all of our pieces are cut and sew, hand dyed. Mm-hmm. We're not buying in bulk and adding our patch to it. We're really creating the pieces from scratch. So there's so much work that goes into the pipeline, to shooting, mood boards, site, like
development.
We Scrapply put together our website and are uploading the product pages and the product descriptions and the email blasts. So, I mean, really, we're kind of any touch point we have our hand in. So it depends on the day, but I feel like we have a running list of to do. Thank God for Ralph.
Yeah.
But it's a Google Doc, and that's what's working for us right now. I don't think it'll work for us like long term, but right now that's our little project management system. And it's really just tackling whatever that day has. Some days it's a crazy amount. Other days it's a lot of content creation and just kind of like vision setting for our future pieces and shoots.
Yeah.
I love that. Mm-hmm. Do you guys have anyone in the business space that you either admire from afar or maybe a mentor of yours that is doing something that you think is really cool?
Yeah. I feel like we're surrounded by so many badass women.
So many.
Someone who we both really, really, really admire is Natalie. She's the founder of Bala Bangles.
Yeah.
And she's just been so instrumental. She's so helpful. Every time I see her, she's like, okay, who do you want an intro to? And how can I help you? And oh, when I was there, I remember feeling this way, but remember this. And I think she's just created an amazing empire, honestly, mm-hmm. and has really tapped into such a niche category and learned how to evolve and grow. I mean, especially stepping into the pandemic, like she wasn't afraid to evolve and to create new things, and she's not afraid of being wrong. She has no ego. I feel like every time we're around her, super inspired by her.
Yeah, and just the fact that she's built this huge brand that pretty much everyone has touched Bala before in their lifetime, but she's so humble and so unassuming, and you would just never know. So I think that's super attractive to Kennedy and I too. She's such an open book and just still the sweetest person ever with all the success, and lives in LA and has a little baby. So she's just someone I think that we want to be like, and it's just nice to have someone to look up that's 10 steps down the road, mm-hmm. but can also remember when she was where we are.
Mm-hmm. So is she from Texas, or am I making that
up?
She
is.
Yeah, she Cuban invested, right? Something like that. Shark Tank. Yep.
Kennedy knows her because they used to demo product next to each mm-hmm. other.
Isn't that crazy?
God, that is crazy.
Actually, I think it was in this building. It was in this building that I met her. Yeah.
Wow.
How funny. Full circle.
Do you guys have any like podcasts that you listen to or books that you've read that have helped you?
I have one podcast I listen to all the time. It's by Bob Goff, the Dream Big podcast.
I love him.
He's literally my favorite person ever. Yeah. I listen to his podcast on my runs like every single day.
Yeah.
But I just love how he's so happy and positive, and
he is so your vibe. I so see why you love him.
No, like 100%.
Yes.
But just his Dream Big framework and how you can kind of go after anything in your life, I feel like it's super inspiring. It's a lot of faith-based different people that he has on his podcast, but I think the Dream Big framework is something that I really learned from starting a business, so I love his podcast.
I love him. He's so nice. Have you listened to the one with, I think he had Jamie Kernlima on?
I think
she, so. Okay, so she's founder of It Cosmetics. I've had her on a few times. I love her. Like, out of, if there's one person that I respect more, I mean, there actually isn't anyone that I love or respect more than Jamie. She's really great, though.
I went and bought her stuff.
Yeah.
Literally after listening to it, I was like, oh my gosh, I never even knew this. I was on the beach in Hawaii listening to it, and I was so inspired. I'm like, we're gonna write a book like she did.
Yeah, no, she's so cool. She I was always the biggest fan of It Cosmetics, and then I had her on a year and a half ago, probably. Wow. But also they were like, well, we want to have our own. There's a book coming out.
Right.
So I read the book early in like one. I'm a big reader though, but in one sitting, and I was like crying. You need to like at least like audible it or
what's
something.
It, called? It something.
Start dream it, dream it. Dream it.
Yeah.
I say that I'm like talking it up. I forget the name. It's such a good book though. As far as like if you want inspiration and also like business tips, she's also someone who is just an open book and will share anything. And I think that's kind of unfortunately like a little hard to come by, but I think it's really, really powerful. And also I think it actually benefits you to share more than it does to keep it in. But I love her. She's great.
She, oh my gosh, so good. And I feel like you're saying, it's just not, we don't feel like other people in our space or industry are competition, you know? Mm-hmm. Like, we are Daily Drills and no one else can be Daily Drills because they're not Kennedy and I, but they can be their own version of their own brand that they want to come up with. So I don't think it hurts to be an open book, like you're saying. I think it helps to share and let other people learn and share all the knowledge just with all the people in the business space that we've befriended along the way. I think it's only helped us to be the most transparent as possible.
Do you guys have a story where, like, maybe it was, like, I don't like the word failure necessarily, but, like, something got messed up. It was really tense. Like, how do you work through those moments? I can tell you do as you're laughing.
Oh, my gosh. It's every other week that the factory, like, underproduces or all of the dyes had to get sent back because they're damaged and they're not, they don't match. The color doesn't match because it's all small batch dye. So it's really hard to exactly match a color. So we've had so many different scenarios where there was a fabric shortage, things were delayed like 3 weeks, and we're like, we have sales goals to meet. And so we've really had to like pivot and be like, okay, we're going to introduce a new product then before. I don't have any specific scenario. I remember when we first launched our Hamilton bra, remember that Kennedy's on the phone. She's like, this is... I was like, oh my gosh, it's not okay. And Kennedy's like, it has to be okay. We're gonna be fine. I'm like, oh wow, I'm normally the positive one, but Kennedy's really feeling good about this. So that was, I think our units were like a tenth of what we ordered came in because the fabric was flown in and it was really, really short. So that was sort of stressful. And we've had a lot of those, like no patches on a huge bulk item that we ordered, or wrong color, or wrong sizing, things like that. But it's
just
not,
roll with it.
It's not been too bad yet. Thank goodness.
Yeah.
It's not been like a fully different item comes in.
Yeah.
It is like, yeah, sure. Yeah.
No, she is like the more carefree one. I'm definitely a little bit more uptight. And at the beginning, I remember, I mean, when something would go wrong, my whole body would just tense up and I'd be like, okay, what are we going to do? How are we going to do this? This isn't right. And now I'm like, okay, it'll work out. Like, no patches. Great. Limited edition. You know, it's just you learn how to roll with it.
Limited edition.
You really do. Yeah. And no one knows, like, you know.
Yeah. That's such a good point. That is so true.
Oh, we've had so many photo shoots where we're literally editing, like in post, putting patches on. It was see-through, but the you know, the actual like end result wasn't, but our photo samples just weren't the actual piece.
Because if you haven't had a fashion brand, so you have photo samples before the actual production comes in, so you can shoot the collection before the collection, the full run actually comes in. So a lot of times the photo sample is the sample right before you finally finalize something. So if the fabric needs to be changed or if a color needs to be altered, you have the sample prior. So you might not have the full exact sample that's what's being sold. So you have to kind of work with what you got, which we've done.
One of my best friends is the like co-owner of Twin Flames. And I hear from her all the time. I'm like, I don't know how you deal with it. It's just, it's so much. But you're right. You have to just be okay with things and pivot. Last question. What do you think has been your biggest lesson in your first, like, year in this business?
Dream big, honestly. I am so risk adverse. I'm scared to start things. And I feel like Daily Drills has really ignited a fire within me to just say yes to things when I know in my gut it's the right yes and to go for it. I mean, I quit my job. I remember being like, oh, if we can just hit this sales number. And then we hit it. And I was like, oh, we can do it. And so I've started like talking big. I'm like, okay, Ralph, so when we have a team of six, here's what we're going to do. And here's the kind of person we're going to hire. And here's a 3PL we need to start thinking about. And I'm starting to hear myself dream bigger. And it's addicting, but it's also just so gratifying to be able to like see your work from start to finish. And that wouldn't have happened if I wasn't able to dream bigger than I could see, you know, right in front of me.
Yeah, I love that advice. And I think that something I always tell other people is to say yes often, because even Kennedy, when she texted me on that Wednesday night, all my job was to do was say yes. But I feel like saying yes seems easy, but in the moment, it's easier to say no. It's easier to let life sort of pass you by. It helps avoid difficulties, avoid challenges, avoid all of those problems that we were talking about. But when you say yes, you're stepping into something that's for you, that I personally believe God made for you and planned for you. So I think that saying yes to things you know in your gut are right, or even new, like saying yes to a podcast and we've never even been on a podcast before. I just think that is, it's very powerful, that small little word. So
I love
say
that.
Yes if you're listening.
I actually lied. I want to end off, what are your matcha, I mean your Alfred orders?
Wow.
I strike you as a matcha girl, huh?
Yeah, I already know.
I do matcha latte, almond milk, iced always. Or if I don't want to do an almond milk very early in the morning, like if I'm trying to intermittent fast,
yeah,
I'll do the white coconut iced tea. It's actually really good.
Oh, I should try that.
It's so
good. That sounds so good. Wait, do you intermittent fast?
I try.
Okay, so when do... Okay, I need to hear more about this because this is something I want to do.
I listened to your episode on it.
Yeah, I like really need to do it. So what time frame do you do?
I do very loosely 12 to 8.
Okay, that's what I'm going to try.
Yeah, it's honestly
what
not
benefits
that bad.
Do you notice?
I just noticed that I'm not as hungry. Like in the morning, I used to wake up starving. I can't eat before I work out, so that has helped me because then I work out in the morning, so I don't have to eat before, which is nice. And after I work out, I normally am not super, super hungry, so I feel like that prolongs it. And the white coconut tea actually comes in clutch because now I don't even, I've done it for years, so now I don't even crave breakfast really. It kind of makes me feel sluggish if I do. But like the podcast I was listening to of yours, he was so right. You kind of have to start slow.
Do you find yourself having more energy with it?
So much
that's
more
what
energy,
I need.
Especially in the morning.
Okay, that's what I need.
Yeah.
All right.
Like,
I mean,
you're like firing.
Right? I know. I'm literally so. Well, I'm getting my labs done with Dr. Cole right now. So, I'm like trying to not change things up until I have that information so I can really tell.
That's so cool.
So,
that's
I'm
smart.
In this weird like in between of like, oh, I don't want to take this or do this. And then try, you know? But anyways, what's your Alfred order?
Well, I'm not fasting. I'm drinking coffee, lots of it. I like an oat milk cap.
Oh, that's good.
Or if I'm doing matcha, an iced oat milk matcha.
Yeah,
unless it's pre-wedding bought, and then I'm iced almond milk.
Your third wedding at this point, right?
My fourth wedding date, I think.
Is it actually your fourth?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh
but it's going to happen this time.
Yeah, no, this time you're actually good.
At 3 months, yeah.
Yeah, you need to really amp up wedding content. And I need, like, TikToks.
Okay.
Your sister killed wedding content on TikTok.
I know.
Killed it.
I need more time in my day.
Yeah.
You need it. Kennedy, I was like, what do you want from Alfred? I know her order, but I was just making sure. And she ordered almond milk. And I was like, oh, wow. We are wedding body ready.
We are new women.
Oh, my gosh. Amazing. Well, thank you guys so much for coming on. Where can they find you guys and also Daily Drills?
At Shop Daily Drills on Instagram and Shop Daily Drills online. And, yeah.
And your Instagram?
Where they can find us personally.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay, I'm at Mary Ralph.
At Kennedy Crichlow.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Thanks, guys.
Thanks so much for having us.
It's a blast. Chase these dreams. Chase these dreams.